to be here tonight, you might as well get up on your feet and help us bless the Lord tonight. Come on.
It wouldn't be a bit surprising if, since the last time we were together, something or somebody tried to get you down. Some satanic force tried to knock you down. Some evil spirit tried to get you down. Some self-centered saint tried to put you down. Some unjust system tried to keep you down. Some fast-talking slickster tried to talk you down. Some short-sighted loan officer tried to turn you down. Some sickening substance tried to pull you down. Some seriously heavy stuff tried to weigh you down. But guess what? If they think they can keep you down, it's too late. The mere fact that you are here today signifies that you are up. In spite of it all, because of it all, through it all in all, you're up. You defied the odds, you're up. You beat the spread, you're up. You overcame the adversity, you're up. You scaled the wall, you're up. You crossed the line, you broke the mold, you're up. That's right. You may not be kicking high, but you're kicking, you're up. You may not be walking fast, but you're still walking. You're up. You may be leaning on a cane, but you're still standing. You're up. You may not have much money, but in so many other ways, you are rich. You're up. You may have just had a breakup, but nevertheless, you're whole. You're up. You may have tripped and stumbled, but you landed on your feet. You're up. You're not just woke. You're up. You've already decided that you're going to wake up to the goodness of God. Get out of the doldrums and the dumps. Stand on the promises of God. Speak up to the people in power. Stand up to the plate and hit a home run. Hurry up and get your act together. Look up to the hills from whence cometh your help. Go up boldly to the throne of grace. Lift up your hands in worship. Open up your mouth and bless the Lord. Are you up yet? Turn to your neighbor and say, I don't know about you, but I'm up. I'm downside up and upside down with praise. I'm up on my feet. I'm up out my seat. I'm up in anticipation of a move of God. Okay, Faith Ministry, since you're up, let's go ahead and pump up the volume. Can you hear me now? Let's lift up our voices, rise up and clap our hands, raise up and praise our God. And now, on the count of three, let's give it up for the Father, give it up for the Son, give it up for the Holy Ghost. One, two, three. Here we go, Faith Ministries. This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Come on and praise the Lord with me. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah, oh hallelujah with me. Yeah, 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 yeah. Hallelujah, oh hallelujah, oh hallelujah with me. With me. Yeah, 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 yeah. Hallelujah.
Here you go. There you go. Praise the Lord. Let's come to the altar. Let's come to the altar as we begin our praise and worship today. We bless the Lord for another privilege, another opportunity to come into His house and to be able to testify to His goodness, His mercy, His greatness, and His kindness towards us. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Matter of fact, we could just come here today and just say that all day for the next 2 hours. Just thank you, Lord. All the many things, all the wonderful things, all the blessed things that have happened in our life, and we know it's because of you. For life, for strength, for health, for power, for joy, for peace, for love, for food, clothing, and shelter, family and friends, for aspirations, for hopes, for dreams. All those things we thank you for. Because there are so many people who don't have those things, and there are so many people who have those things but don't know you're responsible for them. And so, God, we can't vouch for them. We can't talk for them. But because we're here in this sacred space, we can say thank you for ourselves. Thank you for another day. Thank you for another opportunity. Thank you for another chance to come into your house and praise your name. Now, God, if we had a mind to, we could stand here and list all the stuff that's wrong. If we had a mind to, we could talk about the things that are bad, the things that are broken, the things that are messed up. But that's not why we came today. We didn't come to fuss. We didn't come to complain. We didn't come to talk about what's wrong. We came to lift up your holy name. And so, God, we pray now, if there's anything on us, that you would take it off of us. If there's anything that's weighing down of us, that you would take the weight off of us. And so at least for the next few minutes, we can give you all the glory, all the praise, all the attention, all the honor, exalt you in a mighty way. God, we love you and we praise you in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Let all the people of the Lord say amen. 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 Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, amen. I don't know about you. But I feel better, so much better, since I laid my burdens down. Somebody praise the Lord today. Praise the Lord today.
Yeah. says something, no one can say no. Amen? Thank you.
this is a good time for us to think about. This is a good time for us to think about all of the battles that we have. All the battles that we're in right now. A lot of those battles may be financial, it may be physical, it may even be mental or spiritual. And when we look at our own strength versus the task at hand, we realize that we may not be equipped to fight it on our own. But the good news of this song and the good news of the word is that even when we come up against a challenge that is greater than our own abilities, we serve a God who is stronger, who is greater, who is high and above anything we could ever face. So next time we sing this song, I want you to sing it with something in mind, with whatever you're facing in mind. And as you say hallelujah, you've won the victory. You're not just singing lyrics to a song, but you're singing praise to a God who you know is victorious. Come on, let's sing it together one more time. Hallelujah.
Today at Faith Ministries and many other churches around the community is Pink Sunday. Sunday in observance, recognition of breast cancer. And Sister Tracy, will you come now and lead us in our observance?
Thank you. Good morning, Faith. Say good morning to everyone here in the sanctuary. You all look pretty in your pink, so good morning. I want to say good morning to those who are worshiping with us in the back in the cafe, and of course our fellow worshipers at Faith East, and our people who are worshiping multi-platform on social media. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Worship in Pink Sunday. We will not tarry. We are just going to give you some facts, and we're going to celebrate the fact that we are all here to do just that. As you can see behind me, the numbers are important. 1 in 8 women in the United States will develop breast cancer in her lifetime. So if you are on a full row right now, figure out where you are in that number. Most common cancer in American women is breast cancer, and that just follows skin cancer. There are over 3.5 million breast cancer survivors in the United States. And as we are saying hallelujah, let's celebrate the Faith Ministries breast cancer survivors. If you are a breast cancer survivor, please join me here in front, please. Let's keep that applause going for them. It is a rally. It's a rallying cry. And we want to support those who have battled, who are still in the fight, and are overcomers. Come on down. Thank you. Amen. So we want to say thank you, first of all, to the Doctors Wise, because here at Faith Ministries, we do this kind of community outreach, and we so appreciate your support for the mission of Komen, and that is, of course, to end cancer and to find a cure. I also want to point out, I know you all have seen it in the news, and I know you saw it on Channel 10, but if you didn't, I'm not holding that against you, that Beyonce Knowles' dad has breast cancer. And so I say that to say that, men, you are not out of the woods. As you see behind me, more than almost 2,500 new cases of invasive breast cancer are going to be diagnosed in men. So everybody needs to know their risk, okay? All right, so I had my caregivers, I told them that they would come help me. My son Ian is gonna come down and help. And is my husband down here already? Oh, he's on his way, okay, sorry. Had to give everybody a task. Okay, if you all could pass out the, yes, one to each person who's up here. Can we just give them another round of applause? And survivors, once you have your token, if you could take your seat, that would be great. We're gonna get to some more business at hand. Thank you so much, we love you, and you know Faith is always gonna support you. I feel very good and confident in saying that. Thank you so much. So one of the things that Komen Columbus is saying as a member of the board is that we are more than pink. Pink is a great color. I love it for many reasons, but we are more than pink. Komen has a bold goal of decreasing the number of breast cancer deaths by 50% in the U.S. by the year 2026. So we are very close, 2026. Research is going to be the reason we do that. There are four pillars that Komen is, thank you so much, honey. There are four pillars that Komen is emphasizing. The first is research. I could not do this without Jesus and you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Research dollars. So almost 60% of the money that is raised goes toward effective medical treatment. And friends, we have to be in that fight, because for years, all of the research was done on, of all things, men. Yes, we know men get breast cancer, but there are some anatomical reasons that the research needs to be done on women. There need to be better tools to detect, diagnose, and determine breast cancer. And then some of the money goes to improving the quality of life for people who have breast cancer. There are so many people who are under 40. That is a very large group of women who are being diagnosed with breast cancer. If you're under 40, then your insurance doesn't necessarily cover a mammogram, because, as you know, for insurance purposes, it's 40 and above. So the research dollars raised go to improving the quality of life, also for detection, and then biology, environment, genetic, and prevention research to find out what's causing breast cancer and how we can avoid it. And then there are things about care that we need to raise money for: the screenings, the diagnostics, the treatment, the clinical trials. Clinical trials are so important, because along with those research dollars, many of us are not taking advantage of clinical trials, and that applies to every kind of clinical trial. We need to move beyond our memories of what happened with the Tuskegee experiment. We are missing out. We know that breast cancer affects each one of us differently. You see the I want to call them terrible towels, but, and I'm not even a Steelers fan, but they're not. They're these no routine cancer towels that we got from the James. We know breast cancer affects all of us differently. There is no routine cancer, but if we're not in the mix, if we're not in those clinical trials, if we're not raising money, then we're going to be counted out. So we all need to do that. And of course, we know Faith shows up for the Race for the Cure. That's the community part. Over 1 million supporters participate in that walk and the other races throughout the nation every year. That's when we come together as one. Again, we are more than pink. And number four, we are about action. And that is really what Worship in Pink Sunday is about. More than 370,000 advocates are fighting for those research dollars, for funding and access to care. Access to care is so important in our community. So the mission, as we go forward, because this is more than pink and it's not just this Sunday, is to save lives by meeting the most critical needs in our communities and investing in those breakthroughs, because we're going to move toward preventing cancer and curing breast cancer. And I have to tell you all, I can't wait for the day when you turn on the news and that's what I'm saying. When I say Good morning, I'm Tracy Townsend, and we have a cure. That is the day that I think we should all be working toward. So again, thank you, Faith, for joining us, for wearing your pink, and being with us on this Worship in Pink Sunday. Thank you, Dr. Wise.
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Tracy, for your leadership in this cause and throughout our community. We're going to receive an offering now. Every year we do that to support the Susan Komen Fund and to show our support for the cancer effort. Since Sister Darlene started this in our church and cheerleader, spear leader around the city for this, Faith Ministries has always been the number one church in contribution. Every year, Faith Ministries has always been the number one church in contributions. And so ain't no sense of messing that up now. So we want you to give. We talk about doing something. This is something that we can do. I don't know the difference between a beaker and a Bunsen burner, but there are people who know how to do research, people who know what to do in a lab. And so while I can't do it in a lab, I can help them to help not only this generation, but generations to come. So our boys, I think we got some boys coming down here. Do they have baskets? Okay. Oh, they, all right, there you go. Oh, excuse me. Got to give it up, Patrick. You can't hold it. All right, let's stand and come on. Give your best. Give your best. Give your best. And you get a card. Get a card. Get a card. It actually is a magnet.
Good morning. Whether you're here in person or watching online, welcome to Faith Ministries.
And here are today's announcements. Join the marriage ministry on Saturday, November the 23rd at Cooper's Hawk Restaurant for our pre-holiday luncheon and gift exchange. It's going to be held at the Easton location, 12:30 to 3:30 p.m. It's going to be a great time. Don't forget to register today because seating is limited. You can register at faithministries.church/events.
Attention all family and professional caregivers. Sign up today for your free tickets to the Caring for the Caregiver Expo on Saturday, November 2nd at the Boathouse from 9 a.m. till 1 p.m. This is a free event for adults, so get pampered, get fit, get healthy, win prizes, attend lunch and learning sessions, and much more. Doors open at 8:30 a.m. and walk-ups are welcome. For more information, go to caringforthecaregiverexpo.com.
The Men of Faith Choir has rehearsal this Saturday at 10 o'clock. Every man and boy is welcome.
Did you hear that, Caleb? Boys are welcome. You can be in the choir this year.
Boys, I'm a man.
Seriously?
Well, you know men have a lot of responsibilities.
Still a man.
Men have to go to work.
That's better than school.
Men have to take care of their family.
And pay bills.
I'm a boy, but I'm still singing in the choir.
The Men of Faith Choir rehearsal is this Saturday at 10 a.m. Men and boys are welcome to participate. And yes, we'll get you out in time to watch football.
All women are invited to join us next Saturday at 10:30 a.m. for our women's ministry meeting. During the meeting, we will discuss upcoming events that impact the women right here at the church. So ladies, we'll see you this Saturday at 10:30 a.m. Here's your dinner.
Oh, no, I'm fine. Don't worry.
But you haven't eaten all day.
No, I'm saving room for the men's fish fry. It's this Saturday.
It's this Saturday?
Yeah, it's Saturday from 11:30 until 2:30 p.m. What are you doing, Caleb?
I'm cleaning room too.
I know, Caleb. Sandwiches are only $7 and dinners are $10, including french fries, fish, bread, and coleslaw.
That's low prices.
What are you doing?
I'm saving room too.
Well, sounds like I don't have to cook dinner this week.
The Fantastic Fish Fry is this Saturday from 11:30 a.m. until 2:30 p.m. Tickets are available after church in the lobby and walk-ups are welcome as well. See you Saturday.
And those are the announcements for this week.
Be sure to stay connected at faithministries.church. We'll see you next week.
Have a great week.
Bye.
Praise the Lord, and thank you for all of those announcements. I do want to thank you on behalf of Dr. Shirley Wise for a wonderful birthday celebration that she had on last week that you helped to make, and we appreciate that. All the gifts, the cards, the money, and just the well wishes and the prayers. Thank you to Salon for doing that beautiful video, for Sybil for decorations, and for Ave and Thomas for putting together that reception. It was all beautiful, and we thank you for that. Last week, we didn't have a real subject, an official subject for our Do Something series, but I talked about women, and then on Tuesday night, I talked about women, and basically, I tried to answer the question, is the Bible sexist? As it relates to women, is the Bible sexist? And I'm just gonna leave that hanging right out there for a minute. And to find out the answer, you can go to our Facebook page and you'll see the TNT for Tuesday. So you can see that last Tuesday. And this Tuesday, we'll be talking about youth at 6 o'clock, our prayer meeting, and 7 o'clock, discussing things that we can do for our youth. And while I'm talking about youth today, I am announcing the kickoff of our ETC, which is Encourage, Text, and Communicate. It is a program being sponsored by our Faith Children's Outreach Ministry, by Faith in Action, and also sponsored by the Adam H. Board. And what we're going to be doing for the next year is we will be asking young people, adults, to text or to communicate by phone with a young person a positive message, either on a weekly basis, a monthly basis, or a daily basis, so that we can encourage them to live a more positive life. After worship, you will be able to get cards, and on these cards, it will give you some prompts, some kind of messages that you could share or you can text. And then once you share them, don't just share them, but talk about them with your young people. So we'll be doing this for the next year for our preteens and our teens. You'll be hearing more about it, but today I'm kind of just pushing the button and saying go so that we can move in that direction. Operation Christmas Child is in effect. Your shoe boxes will be appreciated, filled with toys. You've already heard about the fish fry and the men's chorus. Now, I want to welcome all of our guests. Let me see the hands of those of you who are guests with us today. If you're a guest of our church, kindly raise your hand. I don't want you to stand necessarily, but if you're a guest, let's see your hand. Let's see your hand. Let's praise the Lord for all of our guests who are with us today. Among our guests is Judge Amy Salerno. She's running for Franklin County Municipal Court. Will you stand up, Judge? She's running for that office, and we're always glad to have you and to have you a part of our worship. We say good morning to our friends and congregation on the east side, Faith East, and to our friends in our Faith Worship Center and wherever you're worshiping today. All right, we want to do birthday now. We want to take up the offering. Everybody born in October, come on. Everybody born in October. October gets twice, right? November, come on. Everybody born in November, come on down. Y'all a rowdy bunch. You better watch them hot November people. November, November, November. November. You don't have to belong to the church. You just need to be born in November. November going once. November going twice. All right, let's stand and sing happy birthday. All the November people.
Oh, happy birthday. Oh, happy birthday. May you feel every day of the year. Happy birthday. Oh, happy birthday. And the best. Happy birthday. Oh, happy birthday. May you feel every day of the year. Happy birthday. Oh, happy birthday. Every day, yes, happy birthday, oh, happy birthday, and the best. Happy birthday.
November, praise the Lord. As our ushers are preparing to receive our tithes and offerings for the morning, I want to remind you that we are still recruiting persons for our young adult ushers ministry. If you are between the ages of 18 and 35 and you want to be a part of that, you can see Sister Brenda Green or Brother Frank Bassett. They will give you information on that. This is offering time. This is the time when we get a chance to give, get a chance to share, get a chance to respond to the goodness of God in our life. We offer sacrifices of praise with our lips, and then we offer the first fruits of our increase. We give our tithes because it is a debt we owe God. It is the minimum that God requires of our giving. We give our offerings because even when we give the minimum, we realize we can't beat God giving. So as our boys position themselves in place, We ask that you would stand. I'm going to ask God's blessings upon these gifts, and then we're going to give joyfully, thankfully, and enthusiastically. God, we come today and we thank you, we love you, we praise you, we bless you. Because everything we have, everything we are, and even everything we hope to be comes from you. And so God, as we return unto you a portion of what you've given unto us, we ask that you consecrate that which we give, consecrate that which is left, and consecrate that which is on the way. In Jesus' name we pray, and for his sake. Amen. Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessing. Heavenly. Praise Father, Son. Standing, follow directions of the ushers, and don't forget our Destiny campaign in the center aisle.
Great God, oh.
I can hear the Lord saying, I'm awake and I've heard your prayer. No matter how you feel, know that I am still in control. Know that I am you, and whatever you need, it's in the room. I can hear the Lord saying, I'm awake and I've heard your prayer. No matter how you feel, know that I am still in control. Know that I am you, and whatever you need, it's in the room. Whatever you need, whatever you need, whatever you need, it's in the room. Whatever you need, whatever you need, whatever you need, it's in this room. Whatever you need, whatever you need,
whatever you need,
whatever you need,
whatever you need,
it's in the room.
It's in the room.
Whatever you
need,
whatever you need,
whatever you need,
in the room.
It's in the room.
Tell somebody, healing is here.
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 It's in the room.
It's in the room.
Say your breakthrough is here.
Your breakthrough.
you need.
It's in the room.
Say whatever you need. Whatever you need.
Whatever you need.
Whatever you need.
Whatever you need.
It's in the room. Know that I am still in control. Know that I am here, and whatever you need, it's in the room. Whatever you need.
Your love is here.
Your love.
in the room.
It's in the room.
Say your love is here.
Your love is here.
Your love is here.
Your love is here.
Your love is here. It's in the room.
It's in the room.
And no matter how you feel, know that I am still in control. Know that I am right here, and whatever you need, it's in the room.
If you heard it, but the song said, whatever you need is in the room. So I dare you to reach up and grab it right now. Come on. Come on, get your joy, get your peace, get your healing, get your love, get your deliverance. Because it's in the room. It's in the room.
Open your hearts, open your hearts.
Whatever you need, whatever you need, whatever you need, it's in the room. Say whatever you need, whatever you need. Whatever you need, it's in the room.
Across the street, not around the corner, but it's in the room. While he was singing that, I was just saying, now Lord, if what I need is in the room, don't make it an Easter egg hunt. When it's Easter egg hunt, you know the egg's in the room, but you got to turn over chairs and look behind the sofa. But God, if it's in the room, show me where it is. Show me it. And then release it. My life might be better. Let's praise the Lord for our young people today. Turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 41 through 47. 41 to 47. Once you found it, will you please stand? 1 Samuel is right before 2 Samuel in the Old Testament. You know, this story involves the whole 17th chapter, but I'm just going to focus on this for a minute and see what the Lord says. 1 Samuel 17, 41 to 47. Let's read together. And the Philistine came on and drew near unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth, and ruddy, and of a fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto him, David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air, to the beasts of the field. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword, and with a spear, and with a shield. But I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee, and take thine head from thee. And I will give the carcasses of the hosts of the Philistine this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with the sword and the spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. God bless you. You may be seated. Can we bow for a word of prayer? Our Father and our God, if you will, let the words of my mouth and even the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, for you are my strength and my redeemer, and all the people of the Lord say amen. We give glory, honor, and praise to God today because he is worthy to be praised. I said he's worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, our God is worthy to be praised. To Dr. Shirley Wise, to all of our preachers, our ministry leaders, our deacons and deaconesses, our guests, our members and friends, I'm glad to be in the service one more time. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield. But I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. If you'll pray with me and help me for a little while this morning, I'd like to talk about why Goliath never had a chance. Why Goliath never had a chance. A young man by the name of David left his house. He was sent by his father Jesse to carry food to his brothers and their commanders on the battlefield. And it wasn't before too long that he ran into a giant. He was just on a simple mission, but he ran into a giant. He wasn't involved in any criminal activity, but he ran into a giant. He wasn't trying to fight. He wasn't trying to be in a fight, but he ran into a giant. He lived in a nice neighborhood, and yet he ran into a giant. Came from a good family. He was just on a simple journey, and he ran into a giant. Reminds me of so many young people in our day who just can't seem to go anywhere without running into a giant. Standing on the bus stop and you run into a giant. Playing on the playground and you run into a giant. Studying in the classroom and you run into a giant. You find yourself anywhere, anyhow, and run into a giant. The giant that David ran into, his name was Goliath. And Goliath physically was a giant man. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, physically, Goliath was a giant man. He was 9 feet 6 inches tall. Do you know how tall that is? Shaquille O'Neal is 7 feet something, so he's 2.5 feet taller than Shaquille O'Neal. He had a helmet of brass on his head. He had shin guards on his legs. He wore an iron coat that weighed 125 pounds. He had a brass target on his chest in between his shoulders. He had a spear, a javelin, that was the size of a weaver's beam, and the tip on the spear weighed 15 pounds by itself. And on top of that, he had a shield, an armor bearer who stood out in front of him. He was a physically giant man. But not only was he physically a giant man, but militarily, he was a giant warrior. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, Goliath was a giant warrior. He came from a fighting nation, the Philistines. Anytime you see Philistines in the Bible, look for a fight, because it's some fighting around. Remind me of a family we had in our neighborhood when I was in Baltimore called the Jacksons. The Jacksons wasn't the Jackson 5, it was a Jackson fight. Wherever they showed up, it was about to be a fight. He came from a fighting nation, the Philistines, and he came from a fighting family. The Bible tells us that he had three other brothers. It was four giants in his family. He was so bad that he was fighting from his youth. He was so bad that he had notches on his belt of all the battles he had won and the people that he had killed. Goliath was a giant warrior. He was a giant man, he was a giant warrior, but symbolically today, for our young people, Goliath represents not only a giant man and a giant warrior, but he represents a giant conglomeration. Everybody say giant conglomeration. That's a big word. But all conglomeration means is he's a whole bunch of giants wrapped up in one. And if you think about it symbolically, when I see Goliath, I see a seven-head monster that our young people have to deal with every day when they run in to giants. And if you don't believe me, let me spell out his name. The G stands for gangs. They have to deal with not just the Bloods and the Crips, but their own little peers, amen. Every crowd that you're in may not be illegal, but it may not be good for you. And the Bloods and the Crips they have to deal with, and then they have to deal with their own peers and their own posse. That's what the G stands for. The O in Goliath stands for opioids and other substances. These are the things that they have to face in terms of the drugs, and not just opioids, but crack and heroin and marijuana and amphetamines and methamphetamines and glue and sugar. Amen. All the other substances that will take their lives away. And the L in Goliath stands for lawlessness. It's the gun culture. It's the violenceness. It's the criminals around their life. It's not only the criminals, but it's also the mass shootings that they have to practice to deal with in school every day. It's not only the mass shootings, but it's the lawlessness of the law. Lord have mercy. It's when the law itself is acting illegal. And then you've got the injustice of the legal system. All of that is a giant that faces our children. And then after the L, you got an I, and the I is for identity. Our young people today don't know who they are. They have so much confusion. They don't know whether they're male or female. They don't know whether they're L, whether they're G, whether they're B, whether they're Q or T, LGBTQ. I got to get that right. They don't know whether they're Christian, don't know whether they're atheist, don't know whether they're agnostic, they don't know whether they're Democrat, independent, or Republican. This identity is such a problem for our young people that many of them drive themselves to death because they can't deal with who they are. The AF in Goliath stands for appetites, the irrational and the insatiable appetites that will take you out of this world. Appetites for people, Lord have mercy. You got people you just got to have, you just got to be with, amen, regardless of what they're doing in your life. And then you got places where you ain't got no business being that you can't stay from. And then you got things that you want to have so much that they end up having you. And then the T stands for technology. Stands for technology because technology is a giant that's about to swallow up all of our children. It's a wonderful thing to have technology, but if you don't use it right, it can take you out. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, technology is wonderful, but if you don't use it right, it can take you out. I'm talking about Facebook. I'm talking about Instagram. I'm talking about social media. I'm talking about Snapchat. I'm talking about getting on the internet. That's what it is, a Snapchat. When you get in, you trap. Thank you, Lord. I'm talking about you get on the internet. There are people out there waiting for you, looking for you to suck you up. And when you get on the internet, can take you out. For technology, and then after technology, the last giant I see in Goliath is the home. Everybody say home. Well, why is the home a giant that can kill you? Because the giants are in the house. The giants are in the house. The giants are in the house. I'm talking about domestic violence. I'm talking about food insecurity. I'm talking about economic instability. I'm talking about child abuse. I'm talking about giants in the house. I'm talking about young people who have no parental support or presence in their life. And the giants that's about to take them out is not just one giant, but a conglomeration of giants. And so this giant that faced David, his name was Goliath. And Goliath stood up in front of David and he threatened to fight him and to kill him. And if you never had read the story, you would think that you would put your money on Goliath. I mean, how in the world could a little boy like David possibly, seriously stand a chance against Goliath? But if you read a little bit closer, amen, if you put the microscope a little bit on focus, you'll discover that Goliath never had a chance. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, when it came to David and Goliath, Goliath never had a chance. Now, I know some of you say, well, Reverend, that don't make no sense. You mean to tell me that this little boy could beat the Goliath and Goliath never had, that's what I'm trying to tell you. Well, how did that happen? Very simply, because David was prepared to fight, to face, and defeat giants before he ever met Goliath. And when you have young people that are prepared to face, to fight, and defeat giants before they meet them, when they leave home and run into a giant, they'll know how to handle it. So let me tell you a few ways that David was prepared, and I'm gonna leave you alone. Number one, he was prepared because he was given responsibility at an early age. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, David was prepared because he was given responsibility at an early age. The Bible says he was the youngest of eight sons that Jesse had, but even though he was the baby, he still had a job. He was a keeper of the sheep. His father, Jesse, didn't allow him to just sit around and watch video games. He gave him a job. His father didn't say, oh, he's the baby. No, you going out, you doing something. You going out and you keeping the sheep. He had responsibility. And you know, the funny thing about it is that giants prey on young people with no responsibilities. Giants prey on young people with no responsibility because young people with responsibilities don't have as much time to get in trouble. I said, if you're a young person and you got responsibilities, you don't have as much time to get, it ain't impossible, but you don't have as much time to get in trouble. Why? Because you got chores to do. You got homework to finish. You got to go to school. You got to go to practice. You got a part-time job. You got to volunteer. You got to go to church. You got to sing in the choir. You got to be on the ushers. You ain't got no time to be messing up because you got responsibilities. And when you have responsibilities, it teaches you accountability, that you are responsible to somebody. It teaches you leadership because it means that people are responsible to you. And then it teaches you commitment, to know that you have a job, you have something to do, and somebody's going to expect you to keep it. And one of the things that we do with our young people is we try to do everything for them and don't give them some responsibilities. I remember we had a family used to live across the street from us, the Williams family, and this lady had about 9 or 100 children. She had a lot of children. We were in the projects, and the project, she had all these children, and we had like a two or three bedroom project. Well, that's nice, but if you got 11 children, that's still small. But one thing I remember about Miss Williams is all of her children had a job. She had little children this big, and they would stand up on a chair and wash dishes. Amen. We've got to give our children some responsibility. Just because you're young don't mean you're going to take out the trash, you're going to wash the dishes, you're going to sweep the floor, you're going to do something, because when you've got responsibilities, it prepares you to meet giants. So he got responsibility at an early age. Here's something else that prepared him, and that is that he was well-rounded at an early age. Now, first thing we know about David is that he was a keeper of the sheep, which means he had a trade. Amen. Everybody ain't going to college, but it's good if you know how to do something that can feed your family. Now, imagine there were some people who went to college and they were looking at David and said, oh, he's just keeping sheep, but David had a steady job. Yeah. Amen. How many of you know there's some people with degrees driving a cab? He had a trade, and not only did he have a trade, but the Bible says he was a musician, which means he had a talent and he had an outlet. See, it ain't always work, you know. Work makes Jack a dull boy if you work all the time, you know what I mean? And so he wasn't just a guy who just worked all the time, but he played music. He probably had some folk that he would jam with every now and then, probably had some iTunes that he would pulled down off the internet. He was well-rounded because he was not only a shepherd, but he was a musician. But not only was he a musician, but he knew how to handle a slingshot, which says to me that if he needed some food, he knew what to do to go get it. What I'm trying to tell you is that if you want to raise a child that can fight giants, you've got to help them become well-rounded. You've got to help them to be proficient in more than one area, because you never know which of those areas is going to break out and make them what God wants them to be. David was a musician, and I guess some people were laughing at David because he was playing little instruments, but guess what? Playing an instrument got him into the king's palace, because when the king was disturbed, who did they call for? They called for little David. David got up there and played his music. He was able to fight giants because he was well-rounded at an early age. That's not all we know about David, is that he was well-rounded at an early age. And not only that, he was able to have responsibility at an early age, but we also know that David faced adversity at an early age. He tells us that one time when he was keeping his father's sheep, he ran into a lion. Another time he ran into a bear. He knew what it was like to face adversity at an early age. We wonder why our children crumble and fall apart in young adult age and middle age. It's because we have cushioned them. We put so many bumpers around them that when they go into life and hit the real life, they don't know how to handle it without the training wheels on it, because we have cushioned them. We've got to allow our children to make some mistakes. We've got to allow them to fall and get up and try it again. We've got to allow them to lose in some games, because unless they know what adversity is, they'll never know how to face giants when they come. Now, I'm not telling you to throw your children in a lion's den or put them in a bear's cub, but maybe a kitten and a cub, I don't know. But what I'm trying to say is, Do not shelter our children so much that they don't know what adversity is. Because you don't know when, you don't know how, and you don't know where, but the day is coming when they're gonna run into a giant. And you do them a favor if you let them know how to deal with adversity before they meet the giant. Some of us, our parents didn't introduce us to adversity on purpose. That's just the life that we had. But I thank God for some of the bumps and the bruises I had. I thank God for some of the places I've lived. I thank God that I know what powdered milk is and government cheese. I thank God I know the difference between a mouse and a rat. Y'all ain't trying to help me. I thank God I know what the projects are. I thank God I know what a car is, and when you get in before you turn it on, you got to pray. I know about all that. I know when you say he can put a roof over your head. I know what it's like when that roof is over your head but it's leaking. But I thank God for the adversity, because the adversity has made me stronger. There's some stuff I can face now, ain't nothing but light work because of what I've already been through. I wish I had somebody in here would help me today. Somebody tell me, after what I've been through, I can face anything. Lord have mercy. After what I've already been through. He had adversity at an early age. But not only did he have adversity at an early age, but he experienced victory at an early age. He didn't just face the lion and the bear. He killed them. He defeated them. And our young people will never know what victory is like unless they experience it early in their life. And we as parents, we have to figure out how we can set them up so that they can experience victory. Now, when I say set them up, I don't mean buying a scholarship for them. I don't mean paying off somebody to change their SAT grades. I don't mean lying about their athletic ability. They're gonna get a crew scholarship. They ain't never been in the water. They ain't never been. I'm talking about coaching them and tutoring them and mentoring them and encouraging them so that they can make little victories along the way and have confidence that they can be victorious. I started doing gymnastics when I was 8 years old. And at eight, I went to my first gymnastic meet in Washington, D.C. Our coach put us in his car, took us over to Washington. We had a meet. And at 8 years old, I won my first medals. I won 2 gold medals and a silver. I won a gold in tumbling, a gold in floor exercise, and a silver in side horse. Now, to be honest, I must admit to you, it was only 2 of us. There's only 2 of us in our age group, you know, so I had to win some. I didn't know that, but I just went. So we got there, and so I got these medals. The first time I was ever in a meet, I won medals. My first experience was a win. I took those medals home. I slept with all 3 of those medals under my pillow for at least a week. And those 3 medals were the first of more than 100 medals I won as a gymnast. At 8 years old, I learned, I got an appetite for winning. And winning was not an option, or not winning was not an option. We in this thing to win. I don't want no participation. I ain't trying to participate. I'm trying to win. Because my first experience was victory. And so we've got to help out children. If you get an A on your spelling test, that's victory. You tackle somebody on the football field, that's victory. If you nail your dance in the dance recital, that's victory. If you just got perfect attendance, that's victory. If you're the student of the month, that's victory. You don't have to be a world-class athlete, but help our children experience victory. And when you experience victory, you won't allow anything less than that to be your lot. And then when you look at this young man, not only did he experience victory at an early age, but he had developed a high sense of self-esteem at an early age. David was comfortable in his own skin. He was happy with himself. David didn't need to use anybody else's armor. He didn't need to be anybody else to make him who he was. He was just comfortable with who he was. And you see, giants like to find people who have low self-esteem. Because what they do is they'll talk about the way you look. They'll talk about the way you act. They'll talk about your weaknesses. And they'll laugh at you and make you feel like you are not anything. They'll do to you what they did to David. When David said, "I'll go fight the giant," they said, "You can't because you are just a youth. You are just a child. You are just a boy." And I don't know if that's ever happened to you, but people will throw the just on you in a minute. Amen. You are just a kid. You are just a woman. You are just 5'1". Amen. You are just somebody that came from the ghetto. And what you do is you say, "Okay, you're right. I ain't gonna dispute you on that. You're right. I am just," but you forgot the end of the just. I'm not just, I'm justified. Because the justified means that God makes up the difference. See, I'm just a boy. I'm just a girl. I'm just a freshman. But when you add God to it, God makes up the difference. Is there anybody in here today that the world really could say, "You are just, but God made up the difference"? When you didn't have money, God made up the difference. When you didn't have your homework together, God made up the difference. When you didn't have tuition, God made up the difference. When you didn't have clothes like everybody else, God made up the difference. When you didn't have lunch money, God made up the difference. I'm not just, I'm justified. I'm what I am because God has made up the difference. And so the reason why Goliath didn't have a chance, we always say that David ran into Goliath, but that's not the way to put it. Because the worst day and the last day of Goliath's life was the day that Goliath ran into David. And when David ran into Goliath and Goliath ran into David, he faced him with divine anointing. Everybody say anointing. Go back to chapter 16 and you'll discover that while David was doing his chores, keeping his sheep, God sent a prophet by the name of Samuel to his daddy's house and said, "I'm going to anoint one of his sons to be the next king of Israel." And the Bible says that Samuel asked Jesse to bring all your boys in front of me. And he brought all of them, the big ones, the tall ones, the old ones. And every last one of them, the Bible says that God said to Samuel, "That's not the one." He came all the way down to 7 sons, had 1 son left. And Samuel turned to Jesse and said, "These all your boys?" He said, "No, we got another one. He's out there keeping the sheep, but that's where we put him, you know, put him out to the sheep." He said, "But I'm not going to sit down till you go get him." They sent for David, the youngest one, and they brought David in. And when he stood in front of Samuel, the Bible says that the Lord spoke to Samuel and said, "This is the Lord's anointing. I want you to lay your hands on him." Here's the point I'm trying to make, that before David stood in front of Goliath, somebody had anointed him. I said, somebody had anointed him. When you anoint a person, that gives them some kind of invisible covering. Your anointing is your invisible covering. Can't nobody see it, but it's there. Can't nobody detect it, but it's there. Well, if you got the Spirit and they got the Spirit, you can detect it. But sometimes you run up to somebody and don't know what repels, you can't mess with them because they got the anointing. I said they got the invisible covering of God on them. You can throw mud at it, but it won't stick. You can try to stain them, but it won't penetrate because they've got an invisible covering. But not only is it an invisible covering, it's an internal empowerment. It gives you power you don't know where it came from. Have you ever been in a situation and God gave you words, you don't know where it came from? God gave you strength, you don't know where it came from. God gave you power, you don't. It's the anointing of God. It's the invisible covering. It's the internal empowerment. And then it's the external manifestation of God's force. When you got the anointing, you got dunamis. Dunamis is the force, the power of God that moves mountains. It's the power of God that heals diseases. It's the power of God that makes demons back up. It's the power of God that puts giants in their place. When he faced Goliath, he faced him with anointing. That's why I'm telling you, you ain't old-fashioned if you anoint your children. You're not old-fashioned if you bring them over here and rub some oil on them. You're not old-fashioned if you put all on their books and all on their clothes and all on their car, all on their, why? Because when you got that anointing, you can face giants. He faced him with divine anointing. And then he fought him with his own ammunition. So David says, okay, all y'all scared to fight Goliath? I ain't scared. And word goes back to the king, and they bring David to the king. And the king says, okay, boy, you're going to fight this giant. Least you can do is take my armor. And king put the stuff on David. You know, his helmet went all the way down to his shoulders. And couldn't even walk in the stuff. He gave it back to the king. Tell you what, I'm going to give you back your stuff. And I'm going to fight this battle with my stuff. In other words, you got to use what you had to get what you want. And what I like about David is he had low-cost ammunition. He didn't have to take out a loan to go buy a tank. He just walked by the brook and picked one up for free. It was low cost. Then it was low tech. He didn't need no batteries. He didn't need to plug it up. All he needed to do was sling it. And not only was it low cost and low tech, it was high efficiency. That's why he got 5 stones. He said, one of these stones gonna get you. And many things we have to do as young people, we have to realize we just can't do one thing. We got to have a plan B, and sometimes a plan C, and sometimes E, D, and F. Why? Because if one of these don't get you, one of them will. He faced him with divine anointing. He fought him with his own ammunition. And then he defeated him with the name of the Lord. He says, okay. He gets up there in front of Goliath, and Goliath said, I don't even believe this. I do not believe this. I've been coming out here for 40 days asking y'all to send me somebody to fight me, and this is the best you can do? You, am I a dog that you're going to beat me with a stick? What is this? He said, I'll tell you what I'm going to do to you, David. He says, I'm going to kill you. That's first thing. Then I'm going to leave your flesh so that the birds can eat them up. And then we're going to kill the rest of the Israelites. That's what I'm going to do. And David said, okay, all right, well, let me tell you something. He said, now you come to me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord, the Lord God of Israel, whose armies you have defied. And Goliath said, did you say a name? I'm coming in a name. Is that all you got? A name? That's all I got is a name. Because this ain't just any old name. I'm not coming in the name of Joe or Josephine. I'm not coming in the name of Benny or Becky. I'm not coming in the name of Howie or Heather. I'm not coming in the name of Jaquan or Jaquisha. I'm coming in the name of Jesus. And if you don't know what that name is, let me tell you what I'm going to do to you. You just told me what you're going to do to me. But let me tell you what I'm going to, so you won't be surprised. I'm going to tell you what first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to come at you in the name of Jesus. And then I'm going to reach in this bag and get one of these stones in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to put this stone in my sling in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to sling that rock around my head in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to watch that rock hit you in your head in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to watch you fall down flat on your face in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to take your sword out of your sheath and chop off your head in the name of Jesus. Then I'm going to pick up your head. I'm going to hold it up so all your Philistine homies can see it in the name of Jesus. And then I'm going to declare that there is a God in Israel. Don't mess with me, David. David said, don't mess with me because I got a name. I'm not talking about what's your name, but what's his name? See, when you know his name, he's Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the Lord of all. He's the master of the world. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the Savior of my soul. He's Mary's baby. He's a rock in a wind. Does anybody know his name? I said, does anybody know his name? When you call his name, demons got to get out the way. When you call his name, trouble don't last always. When you call his name, giants fall. When you call his name, he'll give you power to stand. Somebody praise his name. I said, somebody praise his name. It wasn't the rock. It wasn't the slingshot. It wasn't David. It was his name. That's all I got. That's all I got. I just got a name. But in the name of Jesus, you never had a chance. How children face so many things, so many multiple conglomerations of giants. And when we send them off to school, or off to college, or off to work, or just to the grocery store, we have no idea what giant they're gonna face. But if they learn responsibility early, if they're well-rounded, they know how to handle adversity, if they have experienced victory, if they have a sense of self-esteem, when they get to the giant, they're not in trouble. The giant's in trouble because they'll face it with anointing. They'll fight him with their ammunition, and then they'll throw that name on him. Nothing they can do. I always talk about Jesus. Is like Raid. I know y'all been rich too long. Y'all don't know what Raid is. You know that commercial about Raid? Have you ever noticed that on the commercial, the Raid never sprays? It never sprays. It just comes in the room and says, turn to your neighbor to neighbor. Roaches can read. Ain't got to say nothing. They see R-A-I-D. You back. Come on, man. Let's get out of here. That's all I got is a name. I thought about people who will spend $500,000 to buy entrance for their child into a college. My parents couldn't hardly afford lunch money, but they gave me a name. And when you use this name, it'll open doors for you. whenever you get to a locked door and you don't have the key, use the name. Use the name. Whenever you get to a vacancy and you need something to be filled, you don't know how it's going to be, use the name. And in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Every head bowed, every eye closed. God, we thank you today. Because we know our young people are fighting and facing giants every single day. And all of them threaten to take them out and to kill them. But we thank you, God, that we can prepare our children. We can prepare our young people so that by the time they see the giant, they're already ready. And instead of running, they can stand and fight. I pray, God, if there's somebody here today, a man, woman, a boy, a girl, who doesn't know your name and doesn't know you, they want to become Christians, they want to be saved, they want to be baptized, they want to join the church. God, you know who they are, you know where they're sitting, you know what their situation is, but you also know that if they come, this will be the beginning of a brand new life, a brand new relationship, a brand new walk with you. Maybe there's somebody who's been coming a long time, they've been coming a long time, and in their heart, this is their church, but they've never made it official. God, help them to do that today. Help them to do that today. So they're not just standing on the sidelines, but they're fighting along with everybody else to help bring down the giants in our community so that our young people and all of us can stand. We love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, we pray, and for his sake, let all the people of the Lord say amen. 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 Let's stand all over the church. If you're here, my brother, my sister, come on. If you're in the worship cafe, you want to join the church, come on, come on, come on. If you're there on the east side, you want to join Faith Ministries, come on today, come on, come on. I don't know who you are, don't know where you are, but I believe it's somebody here today. I believe it's somebody here today that needs to come. Don't wait, don't wait. Come on now, come on now. Come on now, while the opportunity is still available, while the doors of the church are still open. Oh, Jesus, oh, precious, we have. In the name, in the name.
Oh, in the name.
We have, we have.
In the name. In the name. Oh, say it up.
Oh, tell who can stand before. Oh, when we call on his. Oh, Jesus, oh, precious, we have. I command you, say it up. I command to pack up for God, for God, for God. To tread, oh Lord, in the name, in the name,
in the name,
in the name, we have, in the name, in the name. If you're facing a giant, if you're facing a giant of any kind, come on to this altar today. If you're facing a giant, come on. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Our Father and our God, we stand here today because there's at least one thing in our life that's bigger than us, that declares it's better than us and seeks to destroy us. We come to you today because we realize that if you did it for David, you'll do it for us. Realize that no matter how big it is, how tall it is, how wide it is, how armed it may be, that in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Some people, it's a health giant. For some people, it's a finance giant. For some people, it's a family giant. Some people, it's an economic or political giant. All of us have a giant. But you have not called us to succumb to giants, but you've called giants to succumb to us. And so God, as we come today, whether we're young or not so young, we stand before these giants without fear. We stand before these giants in confidence, knowing that you can give us the anointing we need to defeat them. God, I thank you. I thank you that you've given us the assurance and the confidence to know that sometimes we may have some adversities, sometimes we may have some trials, but guess what? In the end, we're going to win. And we're not going to wait till it's all over. We're going to give you the glory now. We're going to shout now. We're going to praise you now. We're going to bless you now. We're going to give you the honor now. In the mighty and matchless name of Jesus, let all the people of the Lord say amen. 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 Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, if you are facing a giant, in the name of Jesus, that giant don't have a chance.